Colleagues from the media, good afternoon. The COVID-19 pandemic has heavily impacted the global economy, including driving a sharp drop in global investment flows. UNCTAD World Investment Report 2020 estimates that global FDI projection will decrease up to 40% in 2020. Should this prolong, developing countries will be most at stake. IMF reports large capital outflows of US$83 billion from developing countries since the beginning of the crisis. Developing countries in Asia are also projected to see FDI decline up to 45%. Amidst this pandemic, Indonesia continues to work hard to simplify regulation and bureaucracy, provide incentive, and promote investment opportunities in Indonesia. Investment is a key instrument that can contribute to economic recovery in Indonesia. The Indonesian ambassadors, consul generals, consul, and diplomats have to work harder not only to promote investment opportunities in Indonesia, but also to ensure its realization. Therefore, last Wednesday, the 1st of July, I met Pak Bahlil Lahadalia, Chairman of Indonesia Investment Coordinating Board, and his team to discuss joint collaboration to attract foreign investment in Indonesia. I also spoke with Coordinating Minister for Economic Affairs, Minister of State-Owned Enterprises, and for sure, we'll talk soon with the Coordinating Minister for Maritime Affairs and Investment. And then on Monday, the 6th of July, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs has also launched a dedicated team for the acceleration of economic recovery, which will also undertake efforts to pursue concrete investment projects. So, colleagues, understanding the importance of this issue, today I'm joined by Pak Bahlil Lahadalia, and I'm confident that Pak Bahlil will explain in further details regarding investment policies in Indonesia. I'm also happy to have Professor Wiku Adi Sasmito with us today to convey some further updates on COVID-19. Colleagues, as for today, I will be very brief. So first, my update on the Rohingya people in Indonesia. As I mentioned to you last week, together with the National Task Force for Refugee, I deployed a team to Lok Semawe to strengthen coordination with local government, UNHCR, IOM, and other stakeholders. UNHCR has started its registration process since 5th July 2020. The process is expected to finish by 12th July. And as of today, 65 out of 99 migrants have been registered by UNHCR Indonesia. It is scheduled that by the end of this week, all of them will be moved to their new shelter at Gedung Balai Latihan Kerja Lok Semawe. Indonesian Red Cross Lok Semawe, supported by ICRC and IOM, has also started the Restoring Family Link program to assist migrants to reconnect them with their families. There are 25 minors, ages between 5 until 17 years old, without family in this group. As I mentioned in my previous update regarding two migrants who are treated in the local military health facility in Koren, they are now recovered and have returned to their shelter. In this context, health services in the shelter are also provided to the migrants with mild cases. Meanwhile, Chut Mutia Loksemawe Hospital is also on standby to anticipate migrants with serious condition. Colleagues, my second issue, I'm very happy to update you with the Indonesia-Australia Comprehensive Economic Partnership has officially entered into force on the 5th July 2020. This SEPA was signed on the 4th of March 2019 last year and ratified by the enactment of Law Number 1/2020 on the 28th February 2020. The IATEPA not only covers trade agreement on goods, services and investment, but also cooperation on vocational education training, higher education and health sector. With the IATEPA, Indonesia will benefit among others in the provision of opportunities for Indonesian export to grow with the elimination of Australian import duties to 0%. This will benefit Indonesian export to Australia, such as textile, automotive products, electronics, fish products, and communication tools. The IATEPA also provides a more conducive environment for greater Australian investment in Indonesia, including in the field of higher education. And through the active implementation of IATEPA, there is a potential for Indonesian GDP to increase by 0.23% or an additional of Australian dollar 1.65 billion per year. All these developments are expected to contribute an effort to accelerate the economic recovery. Colleagues, my last point is regarding the update of the status of the Indonesian returnees as per yesterday, 8 July 2020. From 18 March to 8 July, 124,193 Indonesians have returned, which is an additional of 2,555 people from last week's number, or an increase of 2.1%. 71.4% of the total returnees, or 88,710 Indonesians, have returned from Malaysia. This decreased an average returnee per week from around 2,500 to 1,600. It is also due to Malaysia reopening under recovery movement order control per 10 June. While 20.1% or 25,039 Indonesian crews have returned from 35 countries and arriving in Indonesia through 5 entry points in Jakarta and Bali. An additional of 390 people or a 1.6% increase compared to last week. Meanwhile, another 1,444 Indonesians have returned via self-repatriation from 55 countries. This means our repatriation effort have expanded to more than 22 countries in just 4 months. In this regard, in regard to our assistance to Indonesian abroad in need, between 18 March until 8 of July, globally, Indonesian mission in all regions have managed to provide 526,587 packages of basic needs. Particularly in Malaysia, our embassy, consulate general, and consulate, working together with the Indonesian diaspora, have distributed a total of 451,325 packages. Of course, our embassies, consulate general, and consulate will continue to monitor the development through all our mission abroad. So I believe I have conveyed my point, and now I would like to invite Pak Bahlil to brief you on investment issue. And after Pak Bahlil, then I would like directly to invite Pak Wiku Adisasmito to brief you on further updates on COVID-19. Now, I would like to invite Pak Bahlil. Pak Bahlil, dipersilakan. Thank you very much, colleague.
Selamat siang. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya menindaklanjuti perintah Ibu Menlu yang tadi sudah disampaikan tentang bagaimana kita memulihkan sektor investasi di era pandemi COVID-19. Yang pertama, bahwa kami dari BKPM sudah melakukan kerjasama yang baik dengan Kemenlu, khususnya para dubes dan perwakilan-perwakilan BKPM yang ada di negara-negara lain untuk bekerjasama dalam rangka mendorong percepatan masuknya FDI ke Indonesia. Untuk itu, saya akan memberikan sedikit highlight tentang bagaimana gambaran investasi yang ada di Indonesia, dan kemudian saya akan menjelaskan tentang insentif apa aja yang negara siapkan dengan bagaimana mendorong investasi. Yang pertama, bahwa realisasi investasi di 2020 pada kuartal pertama itu sebesar 210,7 triliun. Di mana PMA-nya kurang lebih sekitar 98 triliun dan PMDN-nya 112 triliun. Ini kalau dipresentasikan itu PMA kurang lebih 46,5% dan PMDN 53%. Sudah barang tentu penurunan PMA pada periode yang sama di 2019 ini berakibat karena COVID, dan hampir semua negara di dunia itu melakukan revisi terhadap FDI yang masuk di negaranya. Dari target 2020 untuk investasi yang harus kami lakukan kurang lebih sekitar 886 triliun. Namun sekali lagi kami menyampaikan bahwa karena ini ada COVID, maka sudah barang tentu harus ada penyesuaian tentang revisi target yang dimaksud. Kami di Indonesia, khususnya di BKPM, selain fokus pada FDI yang baru, kami juga sekarang lagi fokus untuk menyelesaikan potensi investasi yang mangkrak, kurang lebih sekitar 708 triliun. Investasi ini sudah berada kurang lebih sekitar 3-4 tahun di Indonesia, namun karena belum terselesaikan, karena ada persoalan izin, kemudian ada persoalan lahan, namun kami sudah menyelesaikan dari 708 triliun, itu kurang lebih sekitar 410 triliun. Sudah selesai, termasuk investasi Vale, kemudian Rosneft, dan Hyundai. Ini sudah clear, tinggal hampir kurang lebih 300 triliun yang harus kita selesaikan. Di semua negara sudah pasti bahwa dalam COVID ini akan mengalami kendala-kendala. Sudah barang tentu Indonesia juga mensiasati untuk bagaimana memudahkan para investor. Apa strateginya? Strateginya adalah sekarang di BKPM dengan Impres nomor 7 tahun 2019, di mana di impres tersebut dari 22 kementerian lembaga yang diberikan kewenangan untuk memberikan izin usaha, sekarang didelegasikan kepada BKPM semuanya, termasuk insentif fiskal, tax holiday, tax allowance, impor barang modal maupun PPN impor. Semuanya di BKPM. Ini semua semata-mata dalam rangka memberikan kepastian, kemudahan bagi investor dalam menjalankan usahanya. Bahkan dalam waktu 2 minggu kemarin, perintah Bapak Presiden kepada BKPM untuk setiap investor, baik dari luar negeri maupun dalam negeri, ketika hendak masuk untuk menginvestasikan modalnya di Indonesia, kewajiban BKPM adalah mengurus izinnya baik dari tingkat pusat, tingkat provinsi, maupun kabupaten kota. Ini adalah sebuah terobosan baru yang harus dilakukan dalam rangka memudahkan para investor. Di aspek yang lain, kami juga ingin menyampaikan bahwa dalam konteks realisasi investasi, Indonesia fokus pada transformasi ekonomi, di mana investasi yang diarahkan pada sektor-sektor sumber daya alam itu kita menitibratkan pada peningkatan nilai tambah. Ada proses hilirisasi industri. Ini akan sangat menguntungkan bagi investor maupun bagi negara dengan tetap memperhatikan kaidah-kaidah norma yang berlaku dalam negara Indonesia. Dalam konteks yang lain, kami juga menyampaikan bahwa BKPM dalam mendorong sektor investasi sekarang selain perkebunan dan pariwisata itu ada 5 sektor yang menjadi target prioritas kita. Yang pertama adalah sektor alat kesehatan. Sebab di masa pandemi baru terbuka bahwa di Indonesia mengalami sebuah apa yang disebut dengan impor 90% dari total kebutuhan alat kesehatan. Nah sekarang kita lagi menyusun, melakukan pendekatan dengan investor yang ingin membangun industri alat kesehatan. Kita akan kasih insentif. Sudah barang tentu pasarnya di dalam negeri sendiri kita akan membuka ruang yang sebesar-besarnya untuk kemudian kelak ketika produknya sudah terjadi, maka target pertama adalah pasar dalam negeri. Yang kedua sektor energi, karena kita masih sangat membutuhkan, sekarang kita juga lagi fokus untuk bagaimana membangun industri baterai yang akan sudah barang tentu kalau ini terjadi akan dibangun oleh GKM dengan BUMN. Ini akan terbesar di Asia. Di sektor pertambangan pasti terus kita akan lakukan karena tidak ada cara lain dalam rangka memberikan nilai tambah, hilirisasi industri itu tetap menjadi rujukan utama. Di sektor manufaktur dan infrastruktur juga salah satu hal yang sangat kami lakukan. Kita tahu semua bahwa Indonesia dalam beberapa hari kemarin, minggu-minggu kemarin, itu sering kita dengar informasi bahwa dalam catatan beberapa lembaga-lembaga dunia, salah satu negara tujuan investasi adalah Indonesia. Ini bukan berarti tanpa alasan, sebab memang Indonesia mempunyai sumber daya alam yang sangat luar biasa, punya cadangan ore nikel 25% sampai 30% dari total cadangan dunia, dan juga adalah mempunyai penduduk produktif yang cukup luar biasa, bahkan 43% dari total pasar ASEAN ada di Indonesia. Nah, oleh karena itu, kita harus, kami khususnya pemerintah, melakukan beberapa langkah-langkah strategis, komprehensif dan terukur untuk membantu investor. Pertama, arahan Bapak Presiden, sekarang kita menyiapkan lokasi kawasan industri yang harganya sangat murah. Saya jamin, harganya di bawah 1 juta per meter. Kalau dibandingkan dengan negara-negara lain di Asia Tenggara, dengan harga 1 juta ini sangat kompetitif sekali. Bahkan dibuka opsi untuk kita melakukan sewa jangka panjang. Sehingga ini memudahkan bagi para investor dalam konteks capex di awal. Yang kedua, kita juga mengarahkan kawasan industri di Batang ini dengan tenaga kerja yang sangat murah. Tenaga kerja berdasarkan UMR di Batang itu 2 juta per bulan. Ini sangat kompetitif sekali. Bahkan di dalam kawasan tersebut, akses tol itu hanya kurang lebih sekitar 250 meter dari eksis tol. Kemudian kereta api jaraknya 200 meter barang. dan kita lagi membangun pelabuhan di mana pelabuhan tersebut merupakan pelabuhan yang dulunya ex Belanda, cukup besar. Dengan kata lain bahwa kawasan industri Batang merupakan kawasan baru yang terbaik di Jawa yang bisa kita membantu untuk mempermudah bagi para investor. Dan saya yakinkan bahwa kalau teman-teman atau para investor datang di Indonesia, cukup datang sampai di airport, nanti kami BKPM yang akan menjemput. Kami akan melayani saudara-saudara selama benar-benar serius. Dan untuk perizinannya, kita akan urus. Teman-teman investor cukup bawa teknologi, bawa modal, kami yang akan mengurus izin dan persoalan di daerah. Saya pikir hanya itu yang perlu kami sampaikan. Terima kasih.
Her Excellency Minister for Foreign Affairs, Ibu Retno Marsudi, Chairman of Indonesia Investment Coordinating Board, Bapak Bahlil Lahadalia, and distinguished foreign media colleagues. It has been 2 months that Indonesia has implemented the donation stratification to monitor and evaluate risk of transmission of every city, region across the country. With the system, we are able to designate a particular sector or areas to ease restrictions in stages based on accurate data calculated with indicators that fulfill public health criteria. Strict protocols are to be the main concern in priority industrial sectors and nature conservation. We can now call COVID-19 is such a clever virus as the national death rate caused by the pathogens does not exceed 5% of the total positive cases. Nevertheless, the swift speed to transmit between one another, even in the asymptomatic patients, is something that draws us all shell shock. Therefore, data navigation and behavior change are the essence to mitigate the invisible threat. But here, to echo the beliefs of many investors across the world, risk comes from not knowing what you are doing. And now we know, and thus we can invest more of our time, our strength, our resources to conquer this virus province by province, district by district, cities by cities, communities by communities, village by village, family by family, to mitigate the risk. Now I will answer questions from the media. The first question is from NHK, Morocco Press Agency. How to explain this upward trend in infections? When will it reach the peak in your assessment? If we see the trend of cases in Indonesia, the number is increasing gradually. And for the last several weeks, it's recorded that more than 1,000 confirmed cases are announced daily. However, we have to recognize that some areas of Indonesia are actively conducting testing. In addition, Indonesia is an archipelago country that has a varied number of confirmed cases. It has 514 districts and cities. Among those numbers, there are 104 districts and cities are in the green zone, meaning it has zero cases or no new cases for more than 4 weeks. We are aware that COVID-19 is a global challenge. Therefore, we still persevere to protect Indonesia from the outbreak and the side effects of the disease by encouraging health protocols implementations for all sectors. As a gigantic archipelago nation, one wouldn't be able to interpret much from the total nation's tally of COVID-19 cases. Consecutive data of each zone could yield much more of the dynamics of the current situation. Moreover, with distinctive background, the residents' way of life also differs one to another. Hence, Every region requires a distinctive approach of intervention. Indonesia relies on the power and local wisdom of each region to collaborate with the central government in order to overcome the pandemic. Second question from NHK, could you tell me if Indonesian government does PCR tests to those who have possibilities of dying from COVID-19 like people in ODP conditions? If not, could you tell me why? Okay. According to our medical experts, PCR examinations is currently preferred to make the COVID-19 diagnosis. The world still relies on the results of the PCR lab, and other testing methods cannot confirm it. As Indonesia is still progressing in optimizing our test capacity, patients and people with close contact with positive cases are still being prioritized for the PCR testing. The ethical matters in investigating a dead body is a delicate issue. In any case of the death, examining the underlying comorbidity in a particular patient is very important. Having more significance than urging efforts for testing a dead body. It is also important to carefully analyze a patient's medical history, even their conditions before they are admitted. The third question from Moroccan news agency, are there any restrictions on Idul Adha to avoid an increase in contamination? Traditions will always be there, and religion-related gatherings have been embedded for generations within Indonesia community. This is a concern for us to help communities to adapt in the midst of the pandemic regarding social activities. The Ministry of the Religious Affairs has anticipated this by issuing a circular letter number 18/2020, which integrates each other activities with health protocols to prevent COVID-19. The letter has been circulated long before Idul Adha so that the community and the government can apply it on the celebration day. National religious movements such as PBNU, Muhammadiyah, and also MUI have been actively encouraging communities to adapt ways of worship in a COVID-19 safe environment. The fourth question from Mainichi Shimbun, hundreds of scientists say coronavirus is airborne. Have you got confirmation from WHO? Upon hearing this update, we have also directly asked confirmation from WHO Indonesia. They cited that they have been actively engaged with a group of scientists since April. Research on airborne transmission is growing, but the evidence is not definitive. Airborne transmission is crowded, closed, and poorly ventilated settings cannot be ruled out. However, the evidence needs to be gathered and interpreted. WHO encourages further research in this area. Along with airborne transmission, we are looking at many other routes of transmission in collaboration with experts from many different fields. WHO will also summarize what they know in a scientific brief on transmission, which will be released soon. In the context of the COVID-19, airborne transmission may be possible in specific circumstances and settings in which procedures of support treatments by generated aerosols are performed, i.e. inserting and removing endotracheal intubation, bronchoscopy, open suctioning, administration of nebulizers, invasive and non-invasive respiratory procedures, and cardiopulmonary resuscitation. A recent publication in the New England Journal of Medicine has evaluated virus persistence of the COVID-19 virus. In this experimental study, aerosol were generated using a 3-jet Pollution nebulizer and fed into Goldberg drum under the controlled laboratory conditions. This is a high-powered machine that does not reflect normal human cough conditions. Further, the findings of the COVID-19 virus in aerosol particles up to 3 hours does not reflect a clinical setting in which aerosol generating procedures are performed. That is, this was an experimentally induced aerosol generating procedure. So based on the available evidence, including the recent publication mentioned above, WHO continues to recommend droplets and contact precautions for those people caring for COVID-19 patients. WHO continues to recommend airborne precautions for circumstances in which aerosol generating procedures are performed according to risk assessment. These recommendations are consistent with other published guidelines, including those developed by the European Society of Intensive Care Medicine and Society of Critical Care Medicine, and those currently used in Australia, Canada, and United Kingdom. The fifth question from Mainichi Simbun. Indonesia's agriculture minister said that a necklace made from eucalyptus can help prevent transmission of COVID-19. Can you clarify that issue? The Ministry of Agriculture confirmed that the product was not claimed to be antivirus and has not yet had clinical trials nor scientific evidence to support it. At present, the study only discussed how eucalyptus is able to inhibit coronavirus replication in silico, which is in a computer simulation. So this is not SARS-CoV-2 virus. This is an early step in the discovery and development process, as only in vitro study has been performed so far. Indonesia has its own uniqueness, possessing cultural and ethical diversity, as well as diversity and natural resources. Plant-derived remedies cannot be separated from the lives of the Indonesians. This is also reflected in the people's perception on handling COVID-19, where the herbal ingredients are believed to have a vital role to increase immunity of our people. Regarding this issue, I have mentioned in the press briefing last week that Indonesia will always hold scientific principles and prioritizes patient safety in developing COVID-19 treatment. The sixth question from NHK. The Bali Provincial Administration is preparing to welcome foreign visitors in September. Can you elaborate on the research or study as the basis of this decision? To update you on Bali's condition, up until the 6th of July, Bali province has 1,900 confirmed cases, which incurs 2.9% of the national cases. There are 7 districts that fall into the medium risk of 2 into the high risk, with Denpasar City having the highest confirmed cases in the province. Bali has one of the highest testing rates at 8,870 per 1 million people, which comes third after Jakarta and West Sumatra. In addition, Bali has a higher recovery rate compared to the national number. Also, it is recorded that there are 5 districts and cities in Bali having 0 deaths due to COVID-19. Bali has been closely coordinating with the national government in order to carefully implement safe and productive activities. This week, Bali Regional Government has issued an updated circular letter specifically to update criteria designated only for travelers besides for tourism purposes. This is necessary in order to carefully screen and control people mobility at the province entrance. Welcoming foreign visitors and reactivating the tourism in Bali, I emphasize, is a plan. This plan is aimed to be conducted by the local government in September, and that is the third stage of the reactivation. There is a strict preconditioning before that, which includes carrying out activities in a limited and selective manner only for the local sphere of the Balinese people starting July as the first step. This includes carrying out essential activities and prioritized sectors, which is advised by the National Task Force. The second step is to carry out a larger step of activities that includes tourism only for national travelers, which will be decided by the Ministry of Tourism. In opening the tourism sector, resembling the economic sector, the government uses public health indicators in assessing the risk of the area in which the tourism will be opened. The opening of the tourism sector follows the development of the zoning status of the region. Areas with green and yellow zoning can begin to open up the tourism sector in stages with the implementation of the strict health protocols. Not only the indicators of the public health, crowd level assessment also determines what interventions will be implemented in a tourism sector. This is all the media questions for today. In closing, yesterday, one of the Indonesia journalists called Indonesia a liability to the region, to ASEAN and the Asia Pacific. We appreciate such a view, but we beg to differ. Indonesia is and has always been an asset to the region, to the world. To our neighbors, we are a family living next to them, which who needs more time to pack if we go out of the house. To the world, we are one of their big brothers who will move their keys when we, along with China, India, and the EU and the US, get healthier, almost half of the world get better. So please allow me to quote a principle that Pak Bahlil Lahadalia and his peer share: never invest in a business you cannot understand. Invest in us, in Indonesia, only if you learn diligently about our progress and our context. So please, again, invest, and thank you. And now I would like to return this to Pak Bahlil. Thank you.
Terima kasih. Saya akan menjawab beberapa pertanyaan dari teman-teman media. Yang pertama tadi ada pertanyaan tentang relokasi pabrik dari beberapa negara ke Indonesia yang kemarin diumumkan oleh Bapak Presiden. Saya ingin menyampaikan bahwa sekarang sudah ada 7 perusahaan yang relokasi dari beberapa negara termasuk China ke Indonesia, dan perusahaan-perusahaan tersebut mulai bulan Juli pertengahan sudah melakukan groundbreaking. Jadi ini bukan perusahaan yang baru rencana, tetapi seluruh perizinannya sudah kami penuhi, bahkan urusan lokasi mereka di mana tujuan investasi pun sudah kami selesaikan. Jadi pertengahan bulan Juli, groundbreaking pertama sudah dilakukan. Yang kedua, selain 7 perusahaan yang sudah relokasi dan groundbreaking, ada 17 perusahaan yang sekarang lagi dilakukan komunikasi secara intens, bahkan progresnya sudah sangat signifikan, sudah ada sampai 80%, dan direncanakan di akhir 2020, perizinannya semua sudah selesai. Yang ketiga adalah ada kurang lebih sekitar 119 perusahaan dari berbagai macam negara, termasuk dari Amerika, yang telah menyampaikan minatnya untuk membangun industri di Indonesia. Kami harapkan bisa tidak membutuhkan waktu yang lama untuk ini bisa diselesaikan. Sudah barang tentu BKPM akan selalu hadir pada garda terdepan untuk membantu para investor yang akan masuk di Indonesia. Yang kedua, ada pertanyaan tentang perkembangan terbaru mengenai proyek kerjasama dengan Tiongkok seperti kereta cepat Jakarta-Bandung dan pembangkit listrik tenaga air Batang Toru. Yang menyampaikan inilah Channel News Asia. Saya ingin menjelaskan bahwa PT Kereta Cepat Indonesia China atau KCIC adalah penanaman modal asing PMA dengan peserta asing dari negara China dengan pemegang saham PT Pilar Sinergi BUMN Indonesia sebesar 60% dan Beijing Yawan High Speed Railway kurang lebih sekitar 40% yang bergerak di bidang usaha angkutan jalan rel untuk penumpang dengan total realisasi investasi sampai dengan triwulan 1 2020 sebesar 33,1 triliun atau 37% dari rencana investasi sebesar 89,3 triliun dengan kebutuhan tenaga kerja saat konstruksi sebanyak 15.000 orang dan saat produksi komersial sebesar 2.000 orang. Kemudian PT North Sumatra Hydro Energy adalah penanaman modal asing PMA dengan peserta asing dari negara Singapura dengan pemegang saham PT Dharma Hydro Nusantara Indonesia kurang lebih sekitar 52,86%. PT Pembangkit Jawa Bali Investasi Indonesia sebesar 25,88%. Ferris Green Energy Singapura kurang lebih sekitar 21,96% yang bergerak di bidang usaha pembangkit listrik tenaga yang berlokasi di Kabupaten Tapanuli Selatan, Sumatera Utara dengan jenis produksi berupa listrik tenaga air memanfaatkan sungai Batang Toru dengan kapasitas sebesar 510 MW dengan total realisasi investasi sampai dengan triwulan 1-2020 sebesar 9,6 triliun atau 44% dari rencana investasi sebesar 21,6 triliun dengan kebutuhan tenaga kerja saat konstruksi sebanyak 1.500 orang dan saat produksi komersial sebesar 100 orang untuk 2 shift. Kemudian pertanyaan yang berikut adalah bagaimana investasi Australia Indonesia selama pandemi? Apakah ada rencana investasi baru? Yang ditanyakan ini dari Australian Financial Review. Saya ingin menjelaskan bahwa pada triwulan pertama 2020, Australia merupakan investor PMA terbesar ke-10 di Indonesia dengan total investasi sebesar 86 juta US dollar dengan total proyek sebanyak 321. Investasi tersebut sebagian besar di sektor pertambangan 64,6%, hotel dan restoran 25,5% dan jasa lainnya 4,2%. Sementara itu, sejak awal tahun sampai dengan Mei 2020, kami berhasil mencatat ada sejumlah 17 perusahaan asal Australia yang berminat untuk berinvestasi di Indonesia di beberapa sektor seperti pendidikan, rumah sakit, pertambangan, pertanian, energi baru terbarukan, industri otomotif, pembangkit listrik, perkapalan dan industri komponen baterai. Di samping rencana minat investasi tersebut di atas, BKPM selama periode Januari-Mei 2020 telah menerbitkan 15 perizinan kantor perwakilan perusahaan asing KPPA dalam rangka penjajakan investasi mereka di masa-masa mendatang di Indonesia. Kemudian ada pertanyaan lagi, bagaimana perkembangan rencana investasi Andrew Forrest di Indonesia? Berapa nilainya? Ini pertanyaan dari Australia Financial Review. Saya ingin menjelaskan bahwa bidang usaha yang mereka ajukan ke BKPM adalah pembangkit listrik tenaga air, hydropower, dan industri pengolahan biji besi, orientasi ekspor, green energy. Lokasi daerah tersebut adalah di Kalimantan Utara dan di Papua. Kalimantan Utara itu memanfaatkan Sungai Kayang yang di dalam perencanaannya itu kurang lebih sekitar ada 11.000 megawatt, dan di Papua di Sungai Mambramo ada kurang lebih sekitar 23.000 megawatt. Perkembangan per 26 Juni 2020 sebagai berikut. Komunikasi intens masih berlanjut sampai saat ini dengan kami pemerintah yang dipimpin oleh Menteri Koordinator Marinvest, oleh Pak Menko Marinvest, seluruh stockholders terkait sudah terlibat dalam rencana investasi yang bersangkutan. Untuk nilai investasi belum bisa disebutkan karena pembahasan masih berlangsung, namun bisa dibayangkan bagaimana pembangunan sebuah PLTA dengan kawasan industri di lokasi remote. Jadi ini saya harus memberitahukan bahwa tim konsultan dari perusahaan yang ada di Australia sekarang lagi di lokasi, dan kami melakukan komunikasi intens dengan pemerintah Provinsi Papua maupun Provinsi Kalimantan Utara. Kita doakan tidak terlalu lama sudah ada hasil. Tetapi dari perusahaan tersebut sangat serius untuk bagaimana bisa merealisasikan investasinya. Pertanyaan yang lain adalah perkembangan terbaru perihal investasi asing untuk ibu kota baru di Kalimantan sebelum COVID-19 melanda. Tony Blair, Abu Dhabi, dan SoftBank menyatakan minatnya untuk berinvestasi di ibu kota baru. Apakah ini masih berlaku dan apa perkembangan terakhirnya? Kami ingin menyampaikan bahwa semua opsi masih terbuka dan tidak pernah ada kita membatalkan. Semuanya berjalan. Namun sekarang karena COVID, jadi memang agak sedikit telat sedikit. Tetapi tidak ada yang keluar dari apa yang telah disepakati. Cuma kemudian skedulnya aja yang agak sedikit mundur. Yang terakhir adalah pertanyaan dari CNA. Tidak ada proyek investasi di Indonesia yang terhenti akibat COVID-19. Pertanyaannya, apakah ada investasi yang terhenti dari COVID? Saya ingin menjelaskan bahwa dari total yang menyatakan minat, bahkan yang telah mendapatkan izin ataupun yang sudah melakukan konstruksi, tidak ada satupun perusahaan yang membatalkan. Yang ada hanyalah schedule mereka, jadwal mereka yang sedikit ditarik. Yakinlah bahwa ke depan Indonesia adalah negara tujuan investasi yang sangat baik. Karena Indonesia telah melakukan beberapa perubahan yang sangat fundamental, terutama terkait dengan perizinan dan kepastian. Kami menyampaikan bahwa Undang-Undang Omnibus Law atau yang disebut dengan Undang-Undang Cipta Tenaga Kerja sebentar lagi akan berakhir, paling lambat di minggu awal bulan Agustus. Ini akan mempercepat dan memperpendek birokrasi dan sekaligus bisa mendapatkan kepastian. Saya pikir demikian atas jawaban dari semua pertanyaan teman-teman media. Dan saya ucapkan terima kasih banyak kepada Ibu Menlu yang telah memperkersai program ini. Terima kasih. Pak.
Well, thank you very much, Pak Bahlil, for your presentation as well as your response to some question from the media. And thank you also, Pak Wipu, for responding to the question and, as usual, for your additional information related to COVID-19. I would like to quote what Professor Wipu mentioned in his last part of his briefing, that Indonesia will always be an asset for our neighbors and to the world. Our neighbors are like jewels. They come in many shapes and colors. Therefore, to see them, we need to wear neutral glasses. I should say, if you wear red glasses to see object, you will only see red objects. But try to wear neutral glasses, then you will see that they are red, yellow, green, and many other colorful objects. These colorful objects will make our life more beautiful and peaceful. So please try. And it is evidence that Indonesia is and will always be part of the solution. So let me now close the briefing by answering question related to foreign policy. First is on the question by Mainichi Shimbun on the updates of Jamaah Tabligh. Colleagues, after a long wait, as well as our consistent and intensive effort, 50 Jamaah Tabligh from Indonesia have been released. 16 of them were repatriated to Indonesia last Saturday, 4th of July. Another 34 are also planned to be repatriated on the 17th July. Considering good relations between Indonesia and India, once again, Indonesia have requested to the Indian authorities to allow the rest of the Indonesian Jamaah Tabligh to return home. Now I would like to respond to question by NHK and CCTV on the topic of the recent developments in Hong Kong with regards to security law and assignment of special task force. Colleagues, for sure, we continue to follow closely recent developments in Hong Kong, especially considering that over 174,000 Indonesian citizens work and live there. Indonesia recognizes that one country, two system principle that govern relations between mainland China and Hong Kong. At the same time, Indonesia underscores the importance of upholding and respecting the value of democracy and human rights. Indonesian Consulate General in Hong Kong will continue to closely monitor this situation in Hong Kong, and furthermore, they have also requested all Indonesian citizens living and working in Hong Kong to stay in touch with the Consulate General should they need any information or assistance. Next, I would like to respond to the NHK question on Indonesia's response to Chinese military drill in South China Sea. Colleagues, Indonesia calls all countries to refrain from actions that may escalate tension in the region. Indonesia underlines the importance of all countries to contribute to maintaining peace and stability in the South China Sea, especially in time like this, where global collective effort is vital in fighting COVID-19. Furthermore, we remain consistent in our call to all parties to respect international law, particularly the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, or UNCLOS 1982. And lastly, I'll give updates on the topic of travel bubble as raised by Morocco Press Agency. Colleagues, the discussion on the essential business travel bubble with a number of countries are still going on. We have started exchanges our draft. We have also received feedback, and we will continue to work closely with them to finalize the arrangement. One thing for sure, that is also mentioned by Professor Wiku, our discussion have also covered strict and thorough health protocol in the arrangement. So colleagues, that is all my answer and our press briefing today. And I hope that I answer all the questions. Once again, terima kasih banyak Pak Bahlil, terima kasih banyak Profesor Wiku, and thank you all of you for joining this week virtual briefing. Inshallah, I will see you next week. Stay healthy, stay strong, and stay united. Thank you very much.